Exactly 10 episodes after the last time this happened, the last game of one episode becomes the first game of the next, with me continuing Guardian's Crusade. Last time we just got tickets for a ship out of Zed Harbor to the Eastern Continent in exchange for giving Kalkanor an important heavy stone. I go to the docks and hand over the tickets to be let on board the Zephyr. First thing I do is go up into the captain's cabin and inspect his phonograph. Nahani finds something next to it and the captain lets us have it, it's just a toadstool. Talking to him normally just has him reassure Nye that there's nothing to be afraid of with sea travel, except for falling overboard. Back outside I go below deck. Nahani is exhausted and we automatically go to our cabin to rest. While inside, the ship sets sail and Nahani wonders what Jungo is like. We go to sleep and after waking we get to explore more of the Zephyr. In one of the cabins we meet it with Darkbeat and Ikby again. Despite him completely destroying me in our fight back in Istan, he says it was the toughest fight he's had in a while. We learn that he's a mercenary so that he can support some group of people, but he refuses to elaborate. Nahani asks if Ikby is a dinosaur or a walrus, to which Darkbeat replies that she's actually his little sister. It's clearly a sore point for them, and when Nahani gets Darkbeat to tell us their story, Ikby stops him. I can go further downstairs into the storeroom to find a chest containing a peach potion. From one of the sacks I can take an apple. There's a dining room where a traveller tells me an evil dragon was confined to God's Tower ages ago. Going back up on the deck, I can chat with Bonnick, who's thrilled to finally be able to open his own shop. Talking to the captain again just has him very aggressively ask if I've ever seen a coconut. Now I've walked around the entire ship, it's time to sleep again. We're woken up with the news that the ship has docked at Jungo, so we get off. This isn't the Eastern Continent, but we have some time to explore before the Zephyr sets off for Triskan. First thing I do is enter the shop and spend 3,300 rubies on a fire sword, 5 points stronger than my dwarf sword. South of the shop is a talking penguin person who found a toy but doesn't want it, so he gives me the living toy Ringsider. Apparently this one just offers commentary? I don't know, the description's vague and I never used it. He's travelling too. Ikby once visited his village far to the north and he asked her to take him with her. He also says that Darkbeat has invited us to visit him, since he lives here. The woman next to him says that Ikby has taken in many children and cares for them as if she was their own mother. Behind them, I can talk with Bonnick, taking in the fact that after years of work, he finally has his own shop. It was a dream his father had too, but he never lived to fulfil it. Darkbeat and Ikby's house is around the centre of the town. Here we can see all the kids Ikby takes care of. One of them she adopted after her parents were indoctrinated into a cult in the town Garum. Another one says it was the Artema cult, one we briefly met some worshippers of in Zed Harbor. Next to him, I can try stealing one of Darkbeat's swords, only for Nahai to say he'll kill me and make me put it back. We can see Ikby either reading a book to some kids or holding a pot of food, I can't quite make it out. Darkbeat is in the basement. He repeats that most of these kids have had their parents taken in by the Artema cult, making them almost like orphans. And since he and Ikby were orphans, they wanted to take care of them. That's why he does the mercenary job. He says that Carmine will pay for this. Carmine is also the name we heard Kalkanor mention last time, the person he wants to save the world from. Well, Darkbeat and Kalkanor seem strong enough to deal with that, so we'll be fine to just deal with our own quest. Darkbeat's also writing his autobiography, referring to himself as a chosen one. I go west and into the house directly across from Darkbeat's and inspect the plant to gain 5 bugs or get better baby since I already had the full 100. On the west side of town, we get to watch a traveller from the ship be reunited with his wife and then immediately ask if she got fat while he was gone. She has good news for him and tells him inside. I enter their house where, as everyone's expecting, the good news is that she's pregnant. Neither of them can think of a name, so he makes the worst decision of his life. He asks me, the person who hates naming things. For his foolishness, I name his unborn son, Dickhead. Only 7 characters, so I had to drop the A. He proudly yells, "Our son will be named Dickhead." To thank me for my help, he gives me the living toy Ditchmobile, which increases my agility for a few turns. I go to the inn and find that the innkeeper was also spying on the couple to relive her own youth. In the south at the town's exit, I can have baby play in a fountain to cool down. In the house opposite the fountain, I go into the basement and inspect a box for a bug. There's a cafe, but baby isn't allowed in and there's no items inside, so I'm not leaving him out on his own for no reason. I leave the town through that southern exit. Jungo is on a small island, so there isn't too much to explore. One guy recommends I follow the path to the lighthouse and back for the exercise. I get moving southeast and in my first battle, finally see baby transform. This time into his fatal frog form, getting all its attacks. The new enemy I face is a Zakra, and it turns out I misremembered 2 enemies at once being the limit as there are 3 here. Killing them also teaches baby a Zakra transformation. My next battle is against my first palette swapped enemy, the Dino Rex, a stronger dino. They have quite a large amount of HP, taking 4 hits each to kill. Baby reaches level 24. At the end of the path, I cross a bridge and reach the lighthouse. I run up several sets of stairs to the top and find a chest with the living toy Miyama inside, which temporarily increases defense. Inspecting one of the lamps along the stairs gets me a strange bug. That's all for the lighthouse, so I head back the way I came. In my first battle, I get to see baby Zakra transformation. It's a bit unnerving with the one baby eye you can see. I buy a 3300 ruby fire armor for 4 extra points of defense over the Roman armor. After resting, I leave town again and take the southwest path. When the path splits, I go south and find some ruins. These are another warp gate I can't use. That's pretty much all there is to explore on this island, so time for a small grind. Another new enemy around here, the Stingbird. Knight reaches level 25. I get to see baby Psycho Cat transformation. On the beach, I face my first Crabera. Nothing remarkable, but killing it gets baby to level 25. Baby uses his Igby transformation a few minutes later. This one is very powerful, as you'd expect. 8 minutes later, Knight reaches level 26. I soon have the money to buy a 3300 ruby fire shield for 3 more defense over the white shield. That's all for this island, so I get back on the Zephyr after keeping everyone else waiting so long. We start in the cabin, and most passengers we talk to are either seasick or just complaining about the rocking of the ship. I go up onto the deck and see that it's pissing it down. That explains the rocking. There's a chest containing one of the few missable living toys, Terroroid, which inflicts terror on an enemy. A sailor reminds me that we're on our way to Triskan on the eastern continent. I go talk to the captain, who's absolutely giddy at being caught in a storm. Running about below deck some more, and baby starts getting seasick too. Nihani suggests we take him above deck for some fresh air. This turns out to be a bad idea, as the storm gets worse and we see some kind of giant sea serpent. The ship rocks hard enough to throw us overboard. Nihani wakes Knight up after he washes up on a beach, but baby is missing. I start looking by heading west into a forest and eventually finding a small village, Kerpel. I head to the middle of the village to find the Kerpelans have baby. They intend to sacrifice baby to please the evil god Ugonga, who they believe will kill them otherwise. I check out the house in the northeast and get stuck between the Kerpelan and some jars. Luckily, this guy offers me a free rest, which spawns me in a different spot after the save so I don't have to reset. In the house east of the middle, I can steal a bean from a jar. The Kerpelan in there says that Ugonga lives in the shrine in the north of the village. In the house south of that one, I can have Knight accidentally drink some glue. Next to it is the chief's hut. I take some money from a barrel and open the chest for the living toy Mudzi, which decreases an enemy's agility. The chief reiterates that they need to sacrifice or Ugonga will kill them, so it looks like I'm gonna kill Ugonga for them. West of the chief's hut is a small girl who feels bad about this. She was supposed to be the sacrifice till baby washed up and they substituted her for him. In the hut north of that is a man who had to sacrifice his wife to Ugonga, leaving his son without a mother. Before taking on the shrine, I do a little grind on the beach in case Knight alone isn't strong enough. The first battle is against a wasp. It has the standard abilities you'd expect of a wasp, stinging you to poison you, firing lasers, taking 3 sword strikes to kill. Next is the flower eye, with a permanent expression as if it's asking for death. Even without the XP split and shared between 2 characters, it still takes 15 minutes for Knight to reach level 27. My next battle is against a strong new enemy, the Rose Devil. This becomes the first enemy in the game to actually poison me. And poison does a huge amount of damage, more than the monster's actual attacks. Luckily, all status effects wear off at the end of the battle. 13 minutes after my last level up, Knight reaches level 28. I decide this is enough and enter that shrine in the north of the village. The first room is just a straight line north. In the second, I get this place's first new enemy, the Cursey. The second room has a couple turns, but is still very straightforward. The third room starts by giving me a chest containing the living toy Pipanic, which confuses an enemy. I go east down a slope and find a second chest with some crystal armor inside. My fire armor is stronger though. I then go south into the fourth room. Right away, there's a chest with a cheeseburger. I go east across a narrow bridge and south to a chest. Now that I'm used to having baby around to carry all my items, having to empty my inventory when it gets full is a little annoying. All for a peach potion. Then it's north into the fifth room. In here, I find Ugonga and take him on. Ugonga has 610 HP. First thing I do is bring out my good buddy Pyro, and on my second turn I bring out Clerisy for regular healing. His attacks only do around 30 to 40 damage, and since he's the only opponent in this battle, that makes him easily manageable. He goes down in a few turns, with Pyro dealing the final blow. Ugonga's dead, but there's still a bit more to do in here. I go east into another room where there's a chest containing a crystal shield, once again weaker than my fire shield. South of that is a second chest with the living toy Hobo Joe, who steals items from an enemy. This is never really useful, as there isn't much worth stealing. This triggers a mimic battle, but they're easily dealt with by now. That's everything in here, so I use Foreman to exit. I'm greeted at the entrance by a Kerpelan. Thankful for us freeing them from Ugonga and the need to sacrifice, they release baby to us. We get to watch their celebratory dance, which is just their walking animation. The chief asks what reward we would like, and Nahani says we need a boat, since we're stuck on this small island. They don't have boats, but they do have Chester. I go to his hut and he gives me the Chester flute, telling me to use it at any body of water. Nahani has no idea what he's talking about. I can also now enter the storeroom in the northeast of the village. It has a chest with the living toy samurai. This one returns any active living toys to my inventory and then uses an attack of its own. Examining the small box in here gets me an apple. I return to the beach and fight a jellyfish man. This is important because this is another transformation for Baby. These were around between Orgo and San Claria, but Baby was never in the party during this and couldn't learn it. I use the Chester flute to see what it's about. Chester is a giant water bug that I can ride across the ocean. I can only summon him and dismount at beaches, but this opens up a lot of new places. The only real downside is that the world is kind of big and he moves a little slow. Travelling large distances can take a while. I start by running along the western side of the western continent. While at sea, enemies are represented by pirate ships, which we fight on. My first sea battle gets me the Anemone enemy. After a few minutes of riding, I eventually reach the northwestern quarter of the continent and get off at the beach that I mentioned between Orgo and San Claria. I take out another Noigan for Baby's Noigan transformation. I accidentally mash through Baby reaching level 26 as I wasn't expecting a level up from such low XP. On Grave Road, I take out a Dino for the Dino transformation, and back in the Cave of Fear, I defeat a Snakera for the Snakera transformation. Finally, there's the Fat Bat for the Fat Bat transformation. Though for some reason, saving Baby at Kerpal does something to his happiness that prevents him from using any transformations unless you do things to mess about with the happiness value yourself. So we won't be seeing much of Baby's transformations for a while. They'll happen still, but they'll be very rare. I next travel to the southmost beach of the western continent. First enemy I face here is definitely the strangest so far, the Coacher. I don't think I've ever battled a carriage with a face before, especially how its punch is just smacking me with a wheel. Someone's been playing Fighters Mega Mix and thought, we can do that in our RPG. I find the nearest road and start following it northwest. The next Coacher I fight shows off a unique ability, hit and run. It'll just charge through us and escape the fight. The path eventually leads to a new town, Den Heldar. This is one of the simplest towns so far, as all the buildings form a square. I check out the door in the southwest corner, but the inhabitant won't let me in and throws a living toy at my head. I gain Insectafly, which reduces an enemy's defense. Next to it is the weapon shop where I buy the 4700 ruby Kuldian sword, 4 points stronger than my fire sword. And for the same price, Kuldian armor, 4 points stronger than the fire armor. 1250 rubies get me the Viking helmet, 1 point stronger than my iron helmet, and for another 4700 for the Kuldian shield, 4 points stronger than the fire shield. I next check out the house in the northwest corner, where the mayor's daughter, Gamella, says the mayor is missing. She believes he's being held captive at the north tower. She says a man with a yellow dinosaur also came by and went to the tower, clearly meaning Darkbeer and Ickby, but they're not back either. In the next house going east, I can inspect the fireplace to find one ruby. I go into the inn, where the innkeeper says he had a guest, a watchmaker from Triskan, who also went off to the North Tower and hasn't come back. That's all for now. To me, the most notable thing about the town is that its music was remixed for the ugly, incomprehensible demo video that played if you left the title screen for a while. Said remix I found quite annoying to listen to. I leave town through the east exit and have a little grind, Knight reaching level 29 from my first battle. A few battles later, Baby reaches level 27. In the end, it took 20 minutes for Baby to reach level 28, then the next battle gets Knight to level 30. Another 20 minutes for Baby to reach level 29. Even an hour into this grind at the same area, I'm still getting new enemies. In this case, it's the Ramble. It takes 12 minutes for Knight to reach level 31. Now it's time to take on that North Tower. From Den Heldar's east exit, I follow the road southeast. Then when I reach a faraway fork, I go north. The long road starts going northwest until I eventually reach the North Tower. Right away, I go south into another room. This is a big room, but first I go east into a smaller room for a chest with a crystal sword. I then go west into another small room where the chest has the living toy Donor, which reduces enemy attack and defense. Back in the main room, I go west to the wall and south all the way to find another little room. The chest in here gets me a devil shield. My habit of buying the strongest equipment at new towns always makes the ones I find in chests obsolete immediately. I then get heading to the room's southeast corner, facing my first buffoo on the way. Its thunderbolt attack causes the first instance of paralysis in this playthrough. It's also one of Baby's transformations, as I learn when I kill it. There's another room in the southeast corner that gets me the living toy Tough Wall. It takes a few turns protecting one of my party from any damage. I then head to the center of the room where there's a pillar and get moving south. I face my first big roaches who start the battle poisoning us both. That's when I learn that Nahani's pixie dust also cures poison. In the center south of the room is the doorway to the next. I go up two flights of stairs to the next screen, which is two more sets of stairs, and then another two. Next room is the pillar and more stairs. At the top of the stairs is a doorway leading outside. Nahani is confused as to where these supposed missing people are, and decides they aren't here and we should head back. First, there's a chest in the southwest corner containing the living toy Vegas. It does something with my look stat, but the menu description doesn't help at all. There's another chest in the northeast corner with some splint mail inside. Once again, obsolete. I trek back down to the first floor and see a blue demon walking off into a secret room. I follow it into this long tunnel that goes downstairs and into the next screen. Then it's even more stairs down. Through the next doorway, I run into Darkbeat and Ikby. Ikby tells Nahani that the missing townspeople are in the next room. Darkbeat's fine with us helping, but tells us to stay out of his way before they move on. Before following, I grab this chest for the living toy Mossman, which reduces an enemy's attacking power. I then follow Darkbeat into the next room to see him confront the blue monster along with a red one. They're working for Carmine and are ready to kill us for interfering. Darkbeat and Ikby will face the red one, so I get the blue one. And most of his body changes colours during the battle transition. The blue monster has 820 HP. I start by bringing out Tough Wall and having it protect Baby. Its missile gun does around 40 damage to Knight, but since Baby is protected, I don't get to see what it does with no armour. I also bring out Good Buddy Pyro. It tries a jet punch, but once again hits Tough Wall. After that, we just beat it down, since after its first turn, it only ever ends up attacking my living toys. This battle also gets Baby to level 30. Darkbeat also took out his monster, and we freed the captives. Darkbeat heads off back to Denheldar to collect the reward. The mayor and two others thank me and leave, but the last one says that the guy from Triskan is still deeper in the tower, so I head south into the next room where there's some kind of teleporter I stand on. Why would you even willingly come through here? To no one's surprise, he's being attacked. The Guardian simply asks if I'm worthy before the battle begins. The Guardian has 1050 HP. Same setup as before, Tough Wall on Baby. Once again, it keeps aiming its attacks at the protected Baby. This time I bring out Da Bomb for the first time since the Galestalk fight. Its burst shot is a tough move as it deals over 60 damage to Knight and hits the entire party. After the second burst shot, I get my first instance of Baby healing himself. I didn't think things through with Da Bomb, as he's so powerful his explosion takes out Tough Wall and does massive damage to Baby, who is then attacked and left with just 21 HP. So I bring out Clarice to keep him alive, and then Pyro to replace Da Bomb. Pyro is the one to get the killing blow. The Guardian leaves behind a chest that grants me a Solomon's Ring. Now I could summon Doomtrain with 6 Malbro Tentacles, 6 Remedy Pluses and 6 Steel Pipes, but none of those exist in this game. Nahani says fairies use it for something, then refuses to elaborate and drops the subject. The man from Triskan thanks me and says that he was sent here by Kalkanor to find a gem, but it looks like there isn't one here, so he leaves to report to him. He introduces himself as Jeddik before he goes, saying I should visit if I'm ever in Triskan so he can give me a present as thanks. It's time for me to leave as well. My first battle outside is against another new one, Cockatrice. It paralyzes me on its first turn and causes Baby's first death in this playthrough, along with my first time running, since I don't want to have to repeat that entire dungeon. I then just avoid all fights on the way back to Denheldar so I can heal and, more importantly, save. I also spend 9,980 rubies on a Cobra Ring to make Knight immune to poison. Accessories cost an insane amount in this game. Back in the mayor's house, Gamella is incredibly grateful for us getting her dad home. The mayor gives me a family heirloom, the living toy Windmeister, which performs a wind elemental attack to a single enemy. That's it for Denheldar, but I decide to have a short 8-minute grind before moving on. Knight reaches level 32, and Baby reaches level 31. I go back near the North Tower to take out a Cockatrice and get my revenge. At the nearby beach I call Chester. There's this island southwest of Orgo Village I want to check out. I get off at the one beach and follow the road southwest until it turns north, leading to a house. The mailbox lets me know that this is the Zepeto family house on Zepeto Island. O'Neill mentioned Professor Zepeto before, as the one who created the living toys. And when we go inside, we can see loads of broken and unfinished toys strewn about the place. There's also this music and I don't know how to describe it. I'm not good with talking about music. It sounds very cosy and nice at first, but there's also this sadness behind it that stood out to me, though I'll get into that more in the next episode. I can go upstairs into a bedroom where there's an old man. Talking to him has O'Neill jump out of us and confirm this is Professor Zepeto. He asks if Zepeto remembers making him, saying it was over 100 years ago. He says he is actually Zepeto Jr., the grandson of the Professor. He came to this island to finish his grandfather's work. He's glad to learn that the living toys have been helpful to us, saying it would make his late grandfather very happy. I can also inspect his cabinet for the Zepeto helmet. This is a huge 38-point increase over the Viking helmet. That's all we can do here right now, so I get going. At this point, I get a bit aimless. Knowing that Zed Harbor's shops will close at some point has me thinking that maybe I should grind out the money now to buy 100 of all the items just in case they close sooner than I am expecting. I spend just about all my money buying 100 steel swords, getting me my third maxed out item. There's an island northeast of this town that I hear has some stronger enemies, so I hope to get good money from them. On the way to said island, I face my first Shellyod and Hogfish enemies. Even these are quite strong. 2 battles later, I get a pair of Serpentines. These are also quite strong right now and can paralyze. After a long trek, I reach this island. The first new enemy I find is the Crabbyfish. These can do over 60 damage to Baby, so I have to be careful. But on the other side, the Crabbyfish is another of Baby's obtainable transformations. About 10 minutes on this island has Baby reached level 32, and a couple more battles get Knight to level 33. But then I realise how impractical this is and decide to just move on with the plot. I return to Eastern. I check out Richten's house to find he ran away after the election, and as far as I'm aware, he's just gone from the game, we never see him again. It seems like the Artema cult has spread to Eastern as well, as at least one guy is here preaching his wisdom. I enter the church to find that Marco has disappeared, being the third from this town alone to do so. There's another Artema follower blocking access to one of the houses, but Nahan isn't standing for any of that and demands they free Marco. I push her aside but run around town a bit more, inspecting this barrel outside the cafe for a terror seed. I go into the inn and check out the clock for a candy bar to fall out. I finally enter the building the follower was blocking. There's a gargoyle blocking my entry into the rest of the temple. He has 500 HP and I do the usual tough wall and pyro, then very easily beat it down. Well, that was easy and Marco is saved. Carmen shows up to check on him and is incredibly thankful for our help. Now they can finally have their wedding. Marco thinks the wedding is still weeks away, but that's because he's been kept in some kind of trance for a while and hasn't realised how long it's been. The wedding's tomorrow, and we cut to the next morning where it's underway. Since we woke up late, we accidentally turn up right after the mayor asks if there are any objections, but everyone laughs it off. We creepily follow behind the couple as they stop to be congratulated by everyone on their way home. Though I do wonder if Marco and Carmen even like these people, as their thanks for the compliments come off rather, "please leave me alone," but maybe that's just me. They go inside the cafe and we just get to watch the outside of the building and see people celebrating in text box form. It goes on for a while, seeing people show up late and buying drinks, but there isn't much to say about it, so let's skip ahead. Knight accidentally drinks booze instead of juice and passes out, some nameless villager being stuck carrying him to the inn. The next morning I go to Marco's house and we get one of the consequences of the hero's canon name being Knight. Thank you for taking part in our wedding, Knight. Carmen gives me the living toy Marilyn, which grants a full heal for 20 PP. This is one that just gets better and better as I level up and get more PP to use it and more HP to heal by while the cost stays the same. The Artema cult is still allowed to operate here for some reason, as the follower outside tries to deny any of what they've been doing. I go upstairs in the temple and find a rotten weed in a jar, and with that, I leave Eastern once again. I next return to the Coastal Inn. There's now a chest I can open containing the living toy Wime, which acts as a decoy and draws all enemy attacks to it. Then it's back to riding Chester on the ocean. I start heading directly south from Zed Harbor. Eventually, I reach a beach on the southwestern corner of the eastern continent. We finally got here after a million distractions. I head east and find an abandoned house with a chest outside. This has the living toy Stair, which outside of battles gives a top-down view of my location, and in battle attacks with an eye laser. It also triggers a mimic fight. At this point, I don't even need the living toys, I can just beat them down. The house is a bit sinister. Flowers and knockers out and messages written in blood, but there's nothing to do here. I just go outside and get following the path north and across a bridge. My first battle is against a Phaedon, and what the hell is its mouth? Despite the size, it isn't that much of a threat. My next battle is against the Bobo Dragon, which is about the same level of strength. This one turns out to be another of Baby's transformations. The path starts turning east and Baby reaches level 33. Continuing east, I finally reach the city Triskan. There's a recruiter at the gate asking if I want to join the Royal Guard. I say yes to start a test battle. This toy Knight has just 280 HP, so it goes down in no time. However, Knight is too young to join the Royal Guard. To make up for it, he gives me the living toy Dr. Snooze, which puts all enemies to sleep. There's several tourists dotted around who are all lost because the tour guide is shit at their job. 4 houses east from the west entrance and I find Jadak's house and can meet his wife, Maris. Talking to Jadak has him thank me with the living toy Tarantula, which poisons all enemies. I talk to a guy outside the house who asks me if I drop this wallet. We take it with the intention to return it to its owner. Nearby is a bell tower I can enter. I climb up several sets of stairs to find a chest getting me the living toy Sacrobat. I can use it when there's another active living toy to return it to me in exchange for damaging all enemies. I can then go up one more floor to ring the bells, but it doesn't do anything special. Across from the bell tower is a girl selling flowers. I can buy a red rose for 300 rubies so that her boss doesn't yell at her today. He also gets night flirted with a bit. Next to the flower shop is the monster training gym. Inside I can beat up a punching bag to knock a hamburger out of it. This is for training Baby. I pay to battle monsters that are always set to a higher level than Baby, and if he wins, he gains stats. The issue is, it's just not very useful. The fights are slow, completely AI controlled, and a single fight costs Baby's level multiplied by 100 rubies, and that's all for one stat point increase. And it's random. The guide I was using said each monster increased a specific stat, but that's just not how it went for me. I had the same enemy increase a different stat each time. I don't know if the guide was mistaken or if it's a change to the PAL version or what. Also, Baby loses the first fight because he isn't automatically healed at the start of the battle, meaning multiple consecutive fights will need a trip to the inn between each one. As I explore some more, I learn that there's a party at the castle that Kalkanor is attending. South of him, a woman says that one of the Atema cultists has returned home, but his daughter is still being looked after by Igby. Next to her, I check this box for some sickweed. East of her is a house where I can go upstairs and find a bug in the barrel in the corner. I check out the armourer and spend 8300 rubies on a demon sword, 8 points stronger than my Kuldian sword. Another 8300 goes to the leopard armour, 8 points over the Kuldian armour, and 8300 once again for the leopard shield, also 8 points stronger than the Kuldian shield. I don't need to buy new helmets for a long time though, since the Sepeto helmet is so good. South a little and west along the street, I find the guy who lost the wallet and return it to him. He thanks me with 1000 rubies. South of him is the weapon shop, and inspecting the sign gets me a freedom route. There's a guy at the pier who forgot his fishing rod, then realises he also forgot to bring his wife. When Nahana grills him over which he cares about more, he doesn't know the correct answer. In the southeast corner of town, I can have a couple ask me to take a picture for them. You get nothing for doing it, but it's a nice thing to do, isn't it? Just don't ask me to do it in real life. Finally, I can enter the castle to the south of town, as it's open to the public. I can stare at a couple in the west of the courtyard to creep them out and get the boyfriend to pay me 500 rubies to leave them alone. Do it again and he tries bribing me with 1000 next. Pushy luck a third time and he gets pissed off and takes all 1500 of it back. For some reason, I then get the idea to try training Baby again. I win 2 fights for 2 extra stats, moving on. I enter the castle. I get to see the king welcoming Kalkanor's group home and wanting to hear about their journey. Kalkanor and Ramal were a bit snappy when we first met, but now they're in a more relaxed setting, they're nicer to us. But a noblewoman near the king feels uneasy about Gwyn Ladin. And considering he gets pissed and calls me a meddling fool when he learns I saved Jadik, yeah, I'm gonna agree. I chat to a random noble for the noblewoman I just mentioned to say her purse has been stolen. Or as she says, somebody stole stolen. Kalkanor has the guards seal off the exit so no one can escape. Baby can sniff out the thief as the nobleman I just spoke to. When Kalkanor tries to inspect him, he runs off. I chase him up the stairs and have him at a dead end, but he runs past us down the opposite set of stairs. There he's caught between all 4 of us. He decides he's going to at least take me down with him and starts a battle. He starts the fight by stealing an apple from me, that bitch. Unlucky for him, he has only 360 HP so he goes down in no time. I take my apple back too. Just as the king is thanking us, Baby runs off on his own. I talk to the noblewoman who rewards me with a water ring, which reduces damage from fire attacks. Before I leave, I chat to Gwyn Ladin, who's still being a creep. Looking for Baby, I leave town through the east exit and follow the road to find Baby at another gate. Nahani asks why Baby ran away, but before she translates his answer, the King of Triskan shows up. He says that those gates are the edge of civilization, and that beyond it is the realm of monsters. Considering there are still 2 human towns past this point, that's a bit of a dick thing to say. Baby tries to say that he was born past that gate, meaning we're getting closer to God's Tower. Grateful for Baby's thief-sniffing skills, the King has the guards let us through. Now I can go through, I go north and get looking for fights. The only enemies in the Eastern Pass are the 650 HP Tartarus. With these, I use Dr. Snooze to put them to sleep, I'm taking no chances with them. They give over 2000 XP, so they're good for grinding right now. Killing my second one gets Knight to level 34. However, while managing my inventory, I do something stupid. I accidentally feed Baby the water ring, intending to make him store it. You can't buy these, so it seems it was the only one in the game, so I'm resetting. Off screen I get back to where I was, but this time I don't feed Baby a rare item. It will turn out much later that I didn't need to reset, but I didn't know at the time. 5 minutes later I get Baby to level 34, then another 5 minutes for Knight to reach level 35, 6 more minutes for Baby to reach level 35. I once again waste money and time at the Monster Training Center, but only manage 4 battles before getting fed up. But then my next recording session, something happens without me noticing. Recently, I've been increasing the brightness on my Elgato and recording games through composite cables like PS1 and N64 games. Since, as can be seen in older videos, the footage usually comes out dark at default settings. For some reason, the Elgato decided to go back to the default brightness for a long time without me noticing, because it all looks the same on my TV. So from here through to pretty much the end of the third episode on this game, things won't look as nice. Sorry about that. Time to actually get through the Eastern Pass. I just keep following the road east. I know I'm out of the pass when I get a new enemy, the Cabra. This one doesn't get to do anything since I keep it asleep. I keep moving east and reach the next village, Garum. First thing I do is enter the shop and spend 9,900 rubies on an Onyx Sword to free more attack over my Demon Sword. Then 10,450 rubies on Onyx Armor, for 4 more defense of the Leopard Armor. Then the same amount for an Onyx Shield, for the same upgrade of the Leopard Shield. A guy of the north of the village says that the path to the next town, Denvrado, and God's Tower by extension, has been blocked off by a landslide that he's still working on clearing out. I go into the mayor's house near the shop, who tells me that there's a giant in the cave to the east of town. There's a child called Anne still in that cave, but the mayor had to have the cave sealed off with her inside to prevent the giant from escaping and wreaking havoc on the village. I inspect one of the mayor's shelves to take a go-go bean. I then go up the western stairs and look through a sack of rice to find a bug. I try the next house to the east, which contains a Neugen farm, where they raise them for food. I try talking to one only to find a hamburger underneath it. The house slightly to the south is Anne's, where her worrying mother prays for her safety. Looking at Anne's teddy bear gets me a rotten weed. With all the treasure collected, I leave to the east. Anne's father is there begging for anyone to save his daughter. The cave is further east. Right away to the west is a chest with the living toy Sumode, which does a physical attack to all enemies. The giant is in the back, just standing there immobile. In fact, Nahani thinks it's actually just a statue and the villagers are just wimps. That's when the giant wakes up and starts a battle. Ruval, as the giant is named, has 1240 HP. As usual, start with Tough War on Baby. Then the guide said to use Contributor. Wait, what? I don't have that one. Turns out I missed a chest all the way back in my first visit to Istan. So I just bring out Windmeister instead, since Ruval is Earth Elemental, I believe. I definitely need Tough Wall here, as even with great armour, Ruval's Earth Bomb does almost 100 damage to Knight, so who knows what it'll do to Baby. I make sure to set Clarissa to Knight to be on the safe side. Even then, Earth Bomb does more damage than Clarissa can heal each turn. He's also got the slightly weaker blaster move which hits the entire party, knocking out Windmeister. Then his Earth Bomb takes out Tough Wall and Clarissa at once. So out comes Reliable Pyro to fireball him in the nuts, which is the finishing blow. Knight reaches level 36 from this battle. Before we can kill him, Anne stops us, saying that Ruval is her friend. Ruval never held Anne prisoner, he was keeping her safe after the earthquake and landslide, and she couldn't get home because everyone else sealed her in trying to keep Ruval in. Anne and Ruval are close enough that Anne knows Ruval would never attack the town. Well, since that's sorted, I guess we can leave. Except, on the way out, Kalkanor, Amal and Gwyn Ladin show up. They walk right past us with the intent of killing Ruval. Nahani tries to explain the situation, but Ramal just apologises and stuns us, making us watch an automated battle between Gwyn Ladin and Ruval. Gwyn Ladin has the powerful Black Sphere attack that does around 250 damage and seemingly infinite health, just tanking everything Ruval throws at him. Kalkanor takes the last of the sacred gems from Ruval, telling Knight that he'll understand what he had to do someday. As they go to leave, Knight regains control and challenges Kalkanor. Like the battle with Darkbeat in Istan, we can't win this one. Kalkanor is too powerful, one attack dealing over 400 damage to Baby, so I'm easily beaten down. Kalkanor recognises Knight's efforts and respects him for it, but Ramal says that they need these gems to save the world before they set off for God's Tower. They just respond by saying they're only doing what they have to do to stop Carmine and the Artema cult. Despite what happened, Ruval still seems to be alive, just injured, as he still talks. This is one of those things I think the game doesn't explain well, as everyone is acting as if he's dead. I talk to Anne's father outside, letting him know his daughter is safe so he can go get her. Anne is crying over Ruval's death despite him not being dead as her father takes her home. Like, Ruval is still in the cave and can still be spoken to, so I'm just confused. But before I move on, I have a living toy I missed that I need to backtrack to. So I go back through the Eastern Pass, through Triskan, to the beach and take Chester all the way back to Istan. I just want to point out that it was a 13-minute journey, because travelling on Chester takes so long. I enter Richten's abandoned house and open a chest for the living toy Contributor. For just 5 PP, it throws 20 rubies at the enemy for huge damage. Then comes the long trek back to Garum. On my way back through the Eastern Pass, Baby reaches level 36. Back in Garum, I leave town to the north and get following the road. It seems the landslide was cleared as I can now enter the mountain road. The only enemy in this area is the Rock Viper. These I just don't mess around with and put them to sleep right away. The road keeps turning east and west all while still going north, with Knight reaching level 37 on the way. Eventually, it takes me to the snowy village Denvrado. At the gate is an old man who also travelled here looking for St. Aruvin's Sanctuary so he can get his disease cured. To the west, a woman is looking for her husband, a zombie. It's his dinner time, but now he's a zombie, he gets confused and forgets things more often. To the west is a singer, and if I accept his offer of a song, he sings about the saviour, Carmine. If I listen to the entire song, he'll sell me a record for 1,000 rubies. The record does nothing. It just exists to be in my inventory. More importantly, as a freebie, he gives me the living toy Hornet. This poisons a single enemy. To the south, I can find the zombie husband behind a house. I tell his wife where he is, but don't get any reward for it. At the north edge of the village against this cliff is Sean. Talking to him lets us see an FMV of the view, where we can finally see God's Tower in the distance. Sean has even seen the stork carrying Baby from the tower. In the northeast of town, there's a monk who's also looking for the zombie husband. It turns out that Aruvin guy somehow accidentally turned the guy into a zombie. The monk considers killing the zombie, but can't bring himself to since he hasn't done anything wrong. This changes the wife's dialogue about how she still loves her husband and doesn't care if he's rotting and smells now. At the village's western exit, a guard tells me I look sick and should see Aruvin about it. Well, as long as he doesn't turn me into a zombie. Aruvin's sanctuary is along this path out of the village, so I get going into the second half of the mountain road. There are still only rock vipers here. Once again, the path has twists and turns, but thanks to the mountains on either side of me, I can't get lost. During this journey, Baby reaches level 37. I eventually leave the mountains and within seconds get a new enemy, the Lyrebird. 720 HP these have, the most of any generic enemy so far. The path is still straightforward here, so I just keep going until the road ends. I keep heading north through some ruins and getting Knight's level 38. Soon after, I reach Aruvin's Sanctuary. The first person I speak to tells me that Kalkanor's group has already set off for God's Tower to face Artema. This person also grants me a free rest. Aruvin is in the back, meditating next to a book, 10 cool ways to sit with your legs crossed and float. I try talking to Aruvin, but he's very clearly sleeping, not meditating. He's also got a bright red suit of armour, but Nahani won't let me steal it. Not because it's wrong, but because she thinks he looks gaudy. East of the sanctuary, the land looks as if it's dying, but we're not going further this episode. Before closing off the game for this episode, let's get one more grind out of the way. The only new enemy here is the Octagug, whatever this is supposed to be. It even has more HP than the Lyrebird. They do grant a nice 2600 XP though. It takes a couple minutes for Baby to reach level 38. But Lyrebirds turn out to be better to grind on. They have less HP but grant 600 more XP. Knight takes 9 more minutes to reach level 39. Baby joins him 3 minutes later. 7 minutes for Knight to reach level 40, 6 more to get Baby to that level. 6 more minutes for Knight to reach level 41, and just 5 minutes for Baby to hit 41 as well. And that's where I'm gonna leave it. I still have the same thoughts I did at the end of the last episode, with the only change being that the slow water bug does add some slight tediousness to the game. But otherwise, I'm still invested and enjoying it. Next episode, we finally take Baby home to God's Tower and find out what the deal with this Carmine guy is.